Good evening and welcome everyone to our third Jefferson Health and Nemours Children's Health joint webinar series. My name is Sarah Breckville and I will be serving as your program facilitator tonight. We are fortunate to have a panel of experts sharing their expertise with us this evening. So we are joined by Danielle Cullen, MD, OBGYN from Jefferson Health, and Robin Brehm, MD, physician from Nemours Children's Health Philadelphia. Well, before I introduce our panel, I do want to encourage you to ask questions by typing in the chat. We will be monitoring questions throughout the session and we'll do our very best to get to as many questions as possible. We would like to note your submissions are not anonymous, so please avoid sharing any personal medical information. We are also recording this evening's program and we will share the link for repeat viewing or sharing with others who may not have been able to attend. Finally, don't worry, we've taken the liberty of muting everyone's line to eliminate that annoying background noise. So feel free to move around and get comfortable. So with that, I want to give each of our physicians a minute to say hello, and then we'll move into our submitted questions for the evening. So Dr. Cullen, we'll start with you. How are you doing this evening?
I'm good, thanks. Am I unmuted?
Yes, you are good to go.
Okay, great. I'm doing great, thanks. I'm glad to be here tonight and to talk about prenatal nutrition and how we can best optimize nutrition during pregnancy and breastfeeding. And happy to be here with Dr. Brehm from Nemours, where my kids go as well. So
amazing. We'd love to hear it. All right. Well, welcome, Dr. Cullen, and welcome, Dr. Brehm, as well. How are you doing this evening?
I'm great. Look forward to talking about nutrition. It's one of my favorite things to talk about.
Yes, it'll be a fun evening for sure. And again, just a reminder to sound off your questions in the chat and we'll have certainly an engaging discussion. Okay, so without further ado, let's just jump into it. So we had a few questions that were submitted this evening that we're going to kick off with. Dr. Cullen, we'll start with you looking at the prenatal side of things. So the first question for the evening, what are your top tips for patients looking to maintain a healthy diet during pregnancy?
That's a great question. It's, I think the general things that go into a healthy diet in general also kind of, you know, adapt to pregnancy. So it's really important to have a varied diet, to have whole grains, vegetables, fruits, and then making sure that you're getting plenty of protein also. I think that's one of the things that people sometimes lack in their diet in general, but specifically during pregnancy because the protein needs go up. We'll talk a little bit more about that later, but you know, the other thing that I think people hear a lot is that you're eating for two and you need to increase your caloric intake, which is definitely true, but it's not eating for two exactly. It's about 300 to 400 extra calories a day. And that's really in the second and third trimesters. A lot of patients ask me, I just feel so terrible. I'm not able to eat anything in my first trimester because I'm so nauseous and I'm so worried about my baby not developing, not getting enough calories. Keeping in mind that at the end of the first trimester, the baby's maybe an inch long, so not needing a lot of calories. So don't worry about it. It's okay. Get in what you can, but don't worry so much about the healthy diet in the first trimester. If you can eat a varied diet, that's great. If you can only tolerate carbs, fine. We'll get back to it later when you can tolerate more things. But really, kind of the main things in the second and third trimester, an extra 300 calories a day and eating that varied diet and trying to make sure that you're getting plenty of protein, and really the goal is 70 to 100 grams a day in pregnancy. Outside of pregnancy, for a woman who's largely sedentary, about 55 to 60 grams is okay in a day, but during pregnancy, really at least 70 grams, and if you're active and working out, probably up to 100 grams of protein a day.
Okay, very helpful and interesting to hear, it's just keeping into consideration the fact that, only an inch long, it equates to 300, not going to be, close to 1,000 calories or anything like that. So that's interesting to hear.
Absolutely not. And I think the other thing, I mentioned protein, but when I think about protein deficiency in pregnancy, I think it's really common that people are not getting enough protein, but just keep in mind that the baby's going to take the protein from you. And so if that means muscle wasting, that means they're getting, protein from where they can from your body, that's what will happen. So really getting enough protein is so important for you to be able to keep your muscle mass and also feed the baby.
Good to know. All right, keep that protein going. Well, thank you. Okay, our second question for the evening that we've definitely been getting a lot of is talking about prenatal vitamins. So if brand matters, do I need a prescription prenatal? What should I look for in a prenatal vitamin?
Yeah, that's a great question and something I talk about a lot in the office as well. So there is going to be a little bit of variability in the amounts of some of the nutrients that are in prenatal vitamins. The whole point of a prenatal vitamin is really to bridge the gap from what you need pre-pregnancy to what you need during pregnancy. So ideally, you're still getting a lot of these vitamins and minerals in your diet, but the prenatal vitamin is kind of helping to bridge. It's important to start a prenatal vitamin if you can, if you're planning your pregnancy, at least a month before you get pregnant. That's really to help increase your folic acid levels. Folic acid is really important very early on. And so if you can kind of bring that up a little bit before you even get pregnant, that's great. That's because it's important for the development of the baby's brain and spinal cord. And that all happens very, very early on. So even in those first few weeks after your missed period, the brain and spinal cord are developing. And so we need that folic acid. The other things that are important are calcium. For most women, that's about 1,000 milligrams a day. That's to help baby's bones and teeth develop. That's in a lot of dairy foods, also dark leafy greens. Some fish have calcium, but that's really important. Iron is important, especially for people who are iron deficient or don't get a lot of meat in their diet. So getting enough iron so that you can have enough blood volume for yourself as well as for baby to make its blood and to deliver oxygen to the fetus is really important. So we see a lot of anemia in pregnancy, and I think some of that's related to not getting enough iron in your diet. So getting some iron is important. Of note, iron can cause constipation. So one of the things that will sometimes drop if someone's struggling with that is there are some prenatal vitamins that don't have iron and some that do. It of course becomes more important if you're iron deficient. Iodine is important. Vitamin A is important. Vitamin C is important. The B complex vitamins are important. And then of course the folic acid, which I already talked about. The amounts are going to be pretty standard across most prenatals. So it doesn't really matter if you get a prescription prenatal or if you get one over the counter. Most of them have similar amounts and enough that it's, you know, going to meet those recommended amounts.
Okay. Well, thank you. And I think as a follow-up to that, a question that we've been getting is that, is it okay if I forget to take my prenatal sometimes?
Absolutely. It's no big deal. Don't double up. There are some vitamins in there that can be toxic if you get to a high enough level of them. So specifically vitamin A, you don't want to take too much. So try not to say, oh, I'll just take a few today. If you miss, don't worry about it. As long as you've been eating some food, you know, with some vitamins in it, no big deal. And even if you really haven't been eating very healthy, a couple days of missed prenatals is not a big deal.
Okay. Great. I think that's reassuring to, for some people listening to this. So thank you. Okay. So just switching gears here a little bit and talking about morning sickness. Do you have some recommended morning sickness remedies?
Yeah. So it's, you know, this is also something I talk about very, very commonly because most people do have some morning sickness. It's very variable. Occasionally I have a lucky patient who's totally fine and has no morning sickness. Most people are somewhere in the middle with some nausea or some just kind of general disinterest in food and this kind of feeling of an upset stomach throughout the day. And then some people are severe enough that they're vomiting and losing weight and unable to stay hydrated. So I think most of my patients come into my office kind of having an idea of what they want to do. Some people say, I'm okay. I'm going to just, you know, try some foods that might help me. And other people are like, I need whatever medications you can give me. So I think going from kind of the least invasive or the most natural to the kind of the more medicinal things. I think most people know that ginger is kind of a known anti-nausea food. So that can be ginger chews, ginger candies, ginger ale. A lot of people will feel better with that. There's some people will feel better with just some, you know, sour hard candies to suck on. Mint teas, candies can also help people feel a little bit better. I think some of the things that, and this is, I mean, for me personally, when I was pregnant and nauseous in the mornings, I kept crackers on my bedside table. I would eat a few crackers before I even got out of bed because an empty stomach can be your worst enemy when you're pregnant and you're nauseous. Also, a very full stomach can be pretty bad. So, you know, you kind of want to eat those small meals throughout the day, try to avoid getting really full, try to avoid really greasy, really fatty foods, certainly spicy foods, which can make it worse. For some people, more protein-heavy meals, back to the protein, but more protein-heavy meals can actually make it better if you can tolerate it. Now, tons of people in the first trimester are like, chicken is my worst enemy. The idea of chicken makes me want to throw up. The smell of chicken makes me want to throw up. So, you know, if you can't, that's fine. But for some people, that does make it better.
Okay.
I will say, just to jump in, I was one of those lucky people who had horrible nausea and vomiting during pregnancy. For me, I heard all of these awesome things that my awesome Jefferson OBGYN told me, but at the end of the day, medicine was really helpful for me. And so, you know, for those that are really suffering out there, you don't have to, if you're puking a million times a day, your doctor has some tips for you too.
Yeah. So there's some over-the-counter things, Benadryl and Unisom will both help. Of note, Unisom is sometimes Benadryl if you pick the wrong one on the counter. Sometimes it's diphenhydramine, which is Benadryl, the same as Benadryl, and sometimes it's doxylamine. Both can work for nausea. Adding a B6 supplement will often help as well. There's also a prescription medication called Diclegis, which is a combination of B6 and doxylamine, which is Unisom. So for some people, that's not covered by insurance, so we just tell them to pick up those components for a few bucks each and kind of combine them on their own. Then there's also a bunch of prescription medications that can either be taken orally or rectally. If for people who really can't tolerate anything by mouth, sometimes the rectal route helps. So we do have lots of medications that are safe in pregnancy that we can use if you need them. We want you to stay hydrated and be able to get some calories in. You know, for some people, their weight stays very stable in the first trimester, and that's okay. Some people lose a little bit of weight. We start to worry a little bit more when you're getting past like 10 pounds of weight loss. But if you lose a few pounds because you're just not feeling like eating or because you're vomiting here and there, not such a big deal. If it's because you're vomiting all the time and you can't keep anything in, you know, that's certainly something we're more worried about.
Okay. And, you know, I'm glad you brought that up because that was a question that we received. Just asking about, you know, if I'm feeling nauseous and I don't have an appetite, what do I do knowing that the baby needs nutrients?
Yeah. Again, that like little 1-inch baby doesn't need too much. It does need hydration. You need hydration. If you're ever feeling like you can't, you know, you're feeling dizzy, you're feeling lightheaded, that's a different story. If you're feeling like you can't keep anything down, you can't keep liquids down, your urine is very, very dark, then you may need to come in and see us in triage so we can give you some IV fluids and give you some IV medications to try to get that under control. But aside from that, don't worry about the baby. The baby's okay.
Okay, I think that's reassuring to hear as well. Thank you. Okay, talking about weight gain or weight loss, what is normal weight gain during pregnancy? And also, what if you're not gaining enough weight?
Great question. So many of my patients come in, especially in the first trimester, totally freaked out that they haven't gained any weight, which is totally normal. Gaining between 0 and 5 pounds is kind of typical in the first trimester. I find that it depends a little bit on how much you're craving carbs and how much you're able to eat other things. For people who are really craving a lot of carbs, sometimes they gain a little on that, you know, more towards the 5 pounds. Some people gain nothing if they're really not able to eat much, and that's okay. The goal weight gain for the entire pregnancy is really based on your starting BMI. So for people who have a low starting BMI, and that's less than 18.5, that's considered underweight. The goal for weight gain for the entire pregnancy is 28 to 40 pounds. So for some of you, that would mean seeing higher numbers on the scale than you've seen before, and that's okay. I know that was true for me. I, you know, got to a point where I was like, well, okay, I've not seen these numbers before, certainly in my third trimester. So it can make people a little bit anxious, but it's totally normal and expected and really necessary, especially for those people who plan to breastfeed. Your body needs that extra fat, and it needs that extra fat store in order to make breast milk. So that's okay. It's hard to see sometimes, but it's okay. For those people who start out with a technically normal BMI, which is between 18.5 and 24.9, the weight gain goal is 25 to 35 pounds for the whole pregnancy. For people who are slightly overweight with a BMI up to 30, the goal is 15 to 25 pounds for the pregnancy. And then for people who have a BMI starting of greater than 30, the goal is between 11 and 20 pounds for the pregnancy. So it differs based on that. In the second and third trimesters, most people for those goal weight gains will be expected to gain about a half a pound to a pound a week, depending on where you fall in that total weight gain goal. And those are great things to talk to your doctor about in person. if you're not gaining enough in the first trimester, not a big deal. If you are very low weight starting out and you're not gaining any weight, your baby is at risk for low weight gain and for being a small for gestational age, which can cause issues for the baby depending on how small they are. So it is important to gain weight. Again, the first trimester, not so important, but second and third trimesters, you need to eat enough calories that you're feeding yourself and the baby.
Okay. And one follow-up to that, what if you're gaining too much?
Yeah, so there is a risk of having a large for gestational age baby if you gain too much weight. So the baby will get some of that weight as well. You may have an increased risk of having diabetes of pregnancy as well. You'll also have probably a harder time losing some of that weight postpartum. That said, I've had some patients who have gained 50 pounds in pregnancy and lost it no problem, and others who have gained 20 pounds in pregnancy and had a hard time losing it. So it's certainly individual, but there is a risk of having a larger baby, and then, you know, the risks that come from that, which include potentially a difficult labor, worse tears, or potentially even needing a cesarean because the baby's too big to fit through your birth canal.
Okay. Thank you. All right. Let's talk about counting calories. You know, is this a necessary practice? And okay, good to know. I see you shaking your head now. And then we also had a question just about managing your calories, wanting to make sure you're getting enough, especially if you're working out every day and pretty active.
Yeah. So most people don't pick up working out in pregnancy. It's usually something that you've been doing beforehand. That's my general finding. Occasionally someone tries to pick up working out, but usually it's people who have been very active before. So the same sort of, I would not encourage people to count calories. I think it makes people a little bit crazy about it, in all honesty. If your weight gain is adequate and your weight gain is appropriate, then I wouldn't worry about it. If your weight gain is too much, you may want to think a little bit about what kind of calories you're putting into your body, or if it's too little. But if you're kind of on those goals, I wouldn't really do it because I think it just makes people anxious. You know, the average number of calories that a non-pregnant woman needs a day, and this is average, so again, different for different people, is about 2,000. So if we're adding 300 to 400 to that a day, that's about what you need. Now, if you're working out so much that you need more calories than that to maintain your weight pre-pregnancy, you're still adding 300 to 400 calories a day, which can be a couple of healthy snacks, a handful of almonds, some apples and peanut butter, you know, something with some calories, but also some protein in it. Again, like varying and kind of adding healthy snacks to your diet, but a couple snacks a day. I wouldn't worry about counting calories. Do what you were doing before and then add a little bit more.
Okay. I think that's very helpful. Thank you. Okay. So we talked a lot about protein and the importance of making sure we're getting enough of it. So are there any specific diet recommendations for vegetarians or vegans?
That's also a really great question and something that comes up a lot in the office. I have a lot of patients who are vegetarian and vegan. And I think one of the struggles that I find is getting, again, enough protein, but also enough iron. So some of my vegetarian and vegan patients get plenty of protein. They eat tofu, they eat other meat alternatives, they eat plenty of cheese and eggs and beans that have protein in them and kind of protein alternative, you know, alternative like non-meat proteins. And some of my patients I find are definitely not getting enough protein. And every suggestion that I have, they say, oh, I don't like that. Oh, I don't eat that. I eat mostly, you know, some vegetables and mostly carbohydrates and lots of pasta, which is a hard thing to work with. Those are patients that I'll try to give tips to and then often also refer to our dietitian to give some extra tips. Nut butters are a great source of protein. But one of the things is really protein and then iron. You know, iron is better absorbed when it comes from a meat source. So that's just how our bodies work. That doesn't mean that iron from things like leafy greens and beans isn't good, but it doesn't, you might need more of it if you're a vegetarian or a vegan. So your goals are going to be a little bit higher. Vitamin D, vitamin B12 are also a little bit hard, both in vegetarians and vegans. So those are things to focus on and to think, am I getting enough of this in a day?
Okay. And you mentioned recommending some of your patients to go see a dietitian. Is that something you would recommend for maybe everyone to go see a dietitian during pregnancy?
I don't necessarily recommend it for everyone. I think that some of my patients have a great grasp on healthy diet and kind of how to add things to continue their healthy diet. I think that for my patients who are worried that they're not having a healthy diet and that they would like to have a more in-depth conversation about diet, I often will send a message to our dietitian Lynn in the office and just have her, you know, reach out to them to set up an appointment. I think for some people, they just don't really have the knowledge about food and that this is a great time to learn about it. And so we take that opportunity to refer people, but I don't think that everyone needs to, because some people really do have a great grasp on kind of proteins and, you know, getting those different vegetables and fruits and kind of what are those protein and nutrient dense foods that you can eat.
Okay. You know, you've definitely been covering this, but I think it would be interesting to hear just some tips on how you should change your eating habits. You know, should you improve them in any way? You mentioned some people like to eat a lot of pasta or certain things that you try to point out, you know, when you're pregnant.
Yeah, so I think most of the things I've already kind of talked about, increasing iron and calcium and protein. I think if you haven't been eating a healthy diet and you want this to be the opportunity where you choose to start trying to eat a healthier diet, certainly I see no problems with that. So I think, you know, aside from the things I already talked about, not a whole lot else to add to that, except that small increase in calories and increased protein, iron, calcium.
Okay. All right. So an interesting question here. What foods do you need to stay away from during pregnancy and why? I know there's a lot of conversation around this, so I'm interested to hear this one.
Yeah, and I think some of this is like an American problem. You know, in other countries, people eat lots of these foods. Nonetheless, our recommendations are what they are. Certainly, unpasteurized milk and unpasteurized soft cheeses you should avoid. There's a risk of some bacteria in them that could cause miscarriage or loss of the fetus. So those are things that I would definitely avoid. Pasteurized cheeses are fine. Pasteurized milk, of course, fine. You should avoid raw or undercooked meats, raw fish, cold cuts, sort of those things are all, that whole list that I just went through is really because of toxoplasmosis, which is a bacteria that can be like in raw meats and raw fish. Things like salmonella and listeria, which are bacteria that can get to the fetus actually and can cause a problem for the fetus. So those are those things. You want to avoid high mercury fish, and there's really only a few. So if you eat fish, please continue. Fish is really healthy. It's a healthy protein. It is it's got lots of vitamins and minerals. It's got omega-3 fatty acids in it. It's a great choice. But you should avoid swordfish, tilefish, shark, and mackerel. Those are really the high mercury fish, and that's, they're large fish. They eat other fish. They accumulate mercury in their tissue. So those are the fish you want to avoid. Tuna is okay in moderate amounts. It's a moderate mercury fish. There are some low mercury tunas you can buy, and then you can have those in any amount. But other fish you should continue to eat. And then you want to just avoid too much added sugar, but that's kind of a general rule. You know, you increase your risk of diabetes, weight gain, high birth weight when you're eating too much processed food and too much sugar.
Right. You say general rule kind of across the board, not only when you're pregnant,
not just in pregnancy.
Yeah.
I talk about that a lot with parents of toddlers. Actually, a lot of what you're saying really relates with parents of toddlers too.
Yes. And no, the toddlers would my own toddler would definitely prefer to eat a cookie for dinner rather than his vegetables, but
yep.
I have one child who eats only carbs and I could, you know, only can get vegetables into him in a smoothie. My second kid, who will eat literally any vegetable in the world and tell me it's his favorite vegetable. And my third, who's somewhere in the middle. So, you know, we're working on it. And you don't have control over all of it. Some of it's their personality. You have control over what you offer them, but
you really do what you can. I like the smoothie trick, though. I think that's good. Okay, so a big question for you here. Is coffee okay during pregnancy?
Yes. There is some evidence that that in high amounts in the first trimester, it can cause miscarriage, or in high amounts in the second and third trimester, it could cause some negative neurodevelopmental effects on your children. So we do recommend that you limit it to about 200 milligrams a day. That's about 2 cups of coffee a day. So I find that most people are fine with that. Some people who are really high intake of coffee have to cut back a little bit, or, you know, try to cut back some, but most people are okay with that, you know, 2 cups or so a day.
Yeah, I heard 1 cup, so 2 cups. I like that. That sounds
I guess
good.
It depends on how big your cup is.
Yeah, that's true.
It's about 12 ounces, so it depends on how big your cup is. If you're drinking a normal cup of coffee, it also depends on how strong it is. So,
okay.
And also keeping in mind that it's not just coffee, right? So chocolate, soda, lots of other things have caffeine in them, teas, that kind of stuff. So trying to keep it around 200. And if it's a little higher than that, it's probably okay. But 350 milligrams is really the upper limit of where it gets to be outside of normal for pregnancy.
Okay, so just one more question related to, you know, particular foods, but I know you mentioned fish is good for you, but is there any like just really good food that you're like, oh, you cannot eat enough of this during pregnancy?
Yeah, I mean, there's a bunch. And I think, again, this is sort of the same things that are those superfoods outside of pregnancy, right? So I think grilled chicken breasts, grilled salmon, things that are high in protein and you know, low in fat are really good for you. Dark leafy greens and broccoli have lots of iron, folate, calcium, vitamin K, vitamin C. So those things, please eat as many dark leafy greens as you possibly can. Beans and peas are another great, you know, they're a great source of iron and protein and have magnesium, potassium, lots of other essential vitamins and minerals in them. I think for especially our non-meat eating patients, almonds and almond butter are really good. You know, they're also kind of a superfood in general. Almonds have lots of iron, protein, healthy fats, vitamin E, fiber. The list goes on for almonds, really. And that's even more than other nuts. Other nuts have good things too, but almonds tend to be the best. Greek yogurt, and Greek I say more than regular yogurt because it tends to be higher in protein and lower in calories. Lower in sugar, especially the plain Greek yogurts. Berries, avocados, eggs, dark chocolate if you need a little sweets at the end of the day. You know, not super sweet, but dark chocolate has tons of good magnesium, minerals, fiber. It's really good for you and kind of a superfood as well.
Okay. Yeah. Again, just I think we all know those healthy foods. We know those superfoods, and it is the same with pregnancy. No magic cure, just eating well.
I will say that as I was thinking about this and I was at the grocery store today because coming back from spring break and then I had to do my grocery shopping today, I bought us a big thing of salmon and leafy greens and, you know, had that for dinner tonight as I was like, oh God, I'm thinking so much about how I should eat, you know, add more healthy fats and leafy greens to my diet.
Salmon, you really can't go wrong.
You really can.
Okay, well, great. Thank you for taking us through that. So just one other question. What are your recommendations for probiotic intake during pregnancy?
I think, you know, there's not really any great evidence either way. I think it's fine. It hasn't been shown to be harmful in pregnancy. I think if you find it helpful outside of pregnancy, it's fine. My preference would probably be to get it from yogurt and food sources. But if you take a probiotic, seemingly it's safe based on studies that we have.
Okay, great. Two questions for you just about postpartum, and then we'll, pick Dr. Brehm's brain a little bit. But what nutrients do I need to think about during the postpartum period?
Yeah, so you really need to continue. Well, this is, I think in general, but specifically for breastfeeding patients, mm-hmm. continuing your prenatal vitamin is really important because keeping in mind that everything that your baby is getting is coming through your body. And so you're losing lots of vitamins and minerals, lots of fat, lots of protein through your breast milk. So you need to keep up with that. You need to continue your prenatal vitamin. You need to get plenty of iron, plenty of protein. You need to continue those healthy fats, which help with your baby's brain development. Vitamin D and calcium, I think, are really important. Breastfeeding and pregnancy are both high bone loss periods for women if they're not getting enough of those. So really important to continue making sure you're getting enough calcium. For me, that was easy. I ate plenty of cheese when I was breastfeeding.
That sounds good.
and, you know, I had to feed the baby, so it was fine to eat all the cheese. And during breastfeeding, it's actually slightly higher caloric intake than even when you're pregnant. So about 400 extra calories a day it tends to be. Now, again, that's going to be variable for different people. And if you have twins that you're trying to breastfeed, you're going to need even more than that, obviously. But this is for a singleton average person who's breastfeeding about 350 to 400 extra calories a day. And the really important thing is hydrating. Hydrate, 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 hydrate. Drink all the water that you can. Keep it next to you when you're breastfeeding. Some people get this sudden urge to drink and are suddenly very thirsty. That's because of the hormone surges, and that's okay. But, you know, have your water near you. Have someone you can call during those, you know, marathon breastfeeding sessions to bring you more water and snacks.
Got it. That's really interesting, the hydrate part. I actually haven't heard that before. So that's something good to keep in mind.
Yeah.
Great.
Well, if babies take about 24 ounces of milk a day, that's 24 ounces of liquid you have to get out of your own body. So
in addition to what you are eating.
Yeah.
And also what your body's using in that extra metabolism. So it's really a lot of extra fluid. Yeah. And people will a lot of times notice a decrease in their breast milk supply when they're not getting enough liquid. And by liquid, I mean not coffee, you know, more like water, Gatorade.
All right, well, good to know. Last question for you. Is there any foods that you should avoid while you're breastfeeding?
Yeah, I really still just those high mercury fish. Mm-hmm. Caffeine is okay, but keep in mind that it does get into your breast milk. And so if your baby's a little wired, it could be because of a little bit of a high caffeine intake, but it doesn't have those same limits that you had during pregnancy, but potentially trying to keep it in the morning and avoiding later night if you're trying to get your baby to sleep more at night. You want to limit alcohol, which I think most people know. It is okay to have a drink here and there when you're breastfeeding. You don't always need to pump and dump, but you know, if you're feeling tipsy, you probably should pump and dump. But a drink here and there is not a big deal during breastfeeding. And then the other thing that I think we wanted to just touch on is just knowing that it's normal to not lose all that baby weight when you're breastfeeding. Dr. Brehm and I were talking about this earlier. Mm-hmm. I myself held on to about 10 to 15 pounds when I was breastfeeding and was able to kind of drop that extra weight once I was done. And I breastfed each of my kids for about a year. So it was fine with me. I didn't really mind. I was able to lose it once I stopped breastfeeding. I've had some patients and friends who have felt like they needed to stop breastfeeding because they were losing so much weight, and others who gained weight during breastfeeding. So it's all normal. There's some, you will be somewhere in there, and that's okay if you choose to breastfeed. Don't worry about it too much while you're breastfeeding. Eat when you're hungry, try to choose healthy foods, and hopefully the rest of it will work itself out. And then when you're done breastfeeding, like I said, some people just hold on to that extra weight because your baby needs those extra calories and needs that extra fat store. So try not to get down on yourself about it.
Yeah, I will say, because I had such a pukey experience during pregnancy, I gained almost all my weight after pregnancy.
It seems like it really runs the gamut in terms of experiences. And like you said, just very individual case by case basis. So, okay, well, thank you. Dr. Brehm, we will turn it over to you. So we have our first question for the evening is submitted from the audience. In the days after a baby is born, what is considered normal in terms of weight loss and weight gain? And is there a point where you would be concerned?
Yeah, great question. That's one of the most common questions that I get from folks in the newborn nursery, actually, when I come meet babies when they're newborn. Almost every baby loses weight. You can lose up to about 10%, in some cases 12% of your birth weight, and it's completely normal. And then they gain it back. Some babies gain weight right after birth. I'm almost never worried about it. Sometimes I question whether we need to remeasure them and our scale was wrong at first if they gained a lot of weight. And babies generally, after they've stopped losing weight, which is usually within the first 5 or so days of life, they start gaining it back at about a half an ounce to an ounce a day.
Okay.
And so if babies are not gaining that weight back, then I start to worry about, are they getting enough? Are they a baby who might need more for some reason? And other types of problems.
Okay, thank you. As a follow-up to that, I guess, talking about nutrition, what kind of nutrition does a newborn need? Do you mind just kind of going into that a little bit?
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, babies need milk or a milk substitute, and that milk has a lot of different things in it. So it has all that protein that adorable little parasite has scavenged from their mother during pregnancy and continues to do so during breastfeeding. Parents are trying to breastfeed. Protein, fat. Fat is a really, really important nutrient for brain growth, and babies are doing a humongous amount of brain growth between 0 and age 3. They get liquid in the form of water. All of the baby's water needs are going to be in their breast milk or formula. And then there's a lot of other nutrients too that are smaller but equally important. So vitamin D is one of the most important nutrients for babies in particular. So again, that bone growth that they're doing, that teeth building that they're doing, all of that is important for vitamin D. And we certainly have seen cases of rickets in our practice in babies who didn't get enough vitamin D. So it's recommended for all breastfeeding parents or chest feeding parents to do a supplemental vitamin D for their baby or to take a very large dose of vitamin D themselves, which you could certainly talk to your obstetrician or pediatrician about. Formula has vitamin D in it, but only if you have enough formula. So babies typically take about 24 ounces-ish at first a day. Often it's a little less, and then it increases over the first month of life. And many babies will be in the range of taking somewhere between 24 to 30-ish ounces a day. Some babies take more, but you don't really get enough vitamin D from formula until you're taking about 30 ounces a day of that. So formula-fed babies need vitamin D too, at least at first. Iron, the iron in breast milk is really bioavailable, so it absorbs better, and then formula has iron supplemented in it. They don't make low iron formulas anymore, actually, because it's so important. And then other types of nutrients too. The things like vitamin B12, folate, all of those other electrolytes that we talked about, calcium, all of those types of things are important for building the body, right? Because that's what a baby's doing. They're building their entire body.
Absolutely. Okay. Well, thank you. As a follow-up, could you maybe remark on some of those stories we were hearing maybe a few months back about the dangers of homemade formula?
Yeah. So just because it looks like milk doesn't mean it is an appropriate milk substitute. It's really the bottom line of this. I actually downloaded TikTok to, I'm totally aging myself here, but I downloaded TikTok to prepare for this talk to see what was going on up there. And I saw a lot of things that were really scary, actually. There's always nutritional fads. And one of the current nutritional fads right now is there's a recipe for formula that's on the internet that is, it contains hemp seeds and dates and sea moss and a bunch of other stuff. And that is not balanced nutrition for a baby. It doesn't have enough calcium and it has way, 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 way too much phosphorus. And those are what your bones are made of. And a really big imbalance between one and the other can lead to really, really bad problems. So there were some babies that were hospitalized at the Nemours Hospital that they actually wrote a case report about in the Journal of Pediatrics, which if anybody was feeling really nerdy, they could look up. But a couple of babies got really, really sick from this with really bad rickets. A while back, there was a popular formula recipe that was circulating that was made of goat's milk, basically. And goat babies are not human babies. Goat babies need less folate than human babies do. Human babies need folate, like we were talking about before with Dr. Cullen, how important that is a nutrient early on in the pregnancy. It's also an important nutrient down the line too, because it's one of the things that helps you make your blood, and you need your blood to deliver oxygen to your body. So goat milk formula, hemp seed formula, none of those are appropriate formulas. None of those are appropriate nutrition for a baby. The only foods a baby needs in the first 4 months of life are milk or a milk substitute. There's a few different kinds of formula out there, but really that's what it boils down to.
Okay, thank you. I think it's an interesting topic in general. Obviously social media and disinformation. And so I think just having this topic and reminding yourself to be, to be aware and listen to your doctor at the end of the day. So thank you for kind of debunking that and doing some investigation on TikTok. We appreciate it.
Because she said this, obviously she means human milk or formula, but milk is also not a substitute for you. Like cow's milk from your refrigerator, not a good substitute.
Species. That's why cow milk and goat milk are not appropriate for human babies.
Cow babies are also not human babies.
So human milk or a human milk substitute. Let's be clear on that. Yeah.
I think, that really paints a very nice picture. Like goats, cows are not human babies. So there we go. Easy as that. Okay, well, thank you. Okay, so one last follow-up to the nutrition-related questions. Any foods to particularly avoid?
Yeah, really good question. All foods are to be avoided until a baby is at least 4 months old. There's a lot of great foods that you can start babies on, but not until they're old enough. So nothing unless your doctor suggests it. Sometimes babies will use a few things kind of as medicine. So sometimes I'll use rice cereal or oatmeal cereal as medicine to thicken up a feed if a baby's having a lot of problems with reflux. Sometimes I'll use juice as medicine for a really constipated baby. But we're using those food items as medicine, not as food. So their babies should not have anything else in the first few months of life. Until age one, babies should not have honey because honey carries a risk of botulism. And until age 6 months, babies shouldn't have water. And then after that, the transition to complementary foods, there's lots and lots of different ways to do that. But the main things to think about are avoiding choking hazards once you're doing that.
Okay. All right. Well, thank you. A few more questions and then we'll take our live submitted questions that we're receiving. Thank you so much for submitting those. But just talking about maybe a feeding schedule, when and how often should newborns be eating? And maybe what are some signs of overfeeding?
Yeah. That's a great question. This is one of the most common questions I get in clinic, actually, because newborn infants are kind of mysterious creatures. They don't have very many needs, but they also don't have very many communication skills. They have their ability to cry and their ability to do a few different things to kind of signal that they're hungry. But parents can get a really good handle on what their own particular infant's cues are to say that they might be hungry. I always tell families that baby for I'm hungry is, and kind of they smack their lips, they look around, they chew on their hands a little bit. That's what newborn for I'm hungry means. Newborn for I'm hangry is wow. So typically babies don't start crying until they're actually really, really hungry. But families often get into a pattern where babies are eating somewhere between every 1 and 4 hours. And that's going to vary throughout the course of the day too, that there may be some gaps in the day where the baby eats a really, really big meal and then takes a good rest. And there may be some times where a baby is cluster feeding or feeding more frequently for a few feeds in a row. So if a baby is saying that they're hungry, they're probably hungry. If a baby pushes away the nipple, delatches from the breast, pushes their face away, then they're not hungry anymore. Generally, babies eat about, like I had said before, about between 24 and 30 ounces by the first month or so of life. At the beginning, their tummies are really, really small, and they only take, like, a newborn on their first day of life can take about 5 milliliters per feed. It's a really, really tiny amount. So that's like a teaspoon is about the size of a baby tummy on the birthday. Then that starts
which goes along with by the end of, the small amount of breast milk that you're making.
Because moms and babies are a good team, just like OBGYN, pediatrics. So, you know, that's you're not making much because you don't need much. And the baby doesn't, you know, the baby is doing fine. Baby gets exactly what they need from that colostrum those first few hours to days of life. And then their stomach gets bigger and the amount of milk that gets made gets bigger. And all of that kind of happens together. So even if a baby's eating formula from the first day of life, their stomach still is not big enough to take 2 ounces of formula. And that still takes some time for their stomachs to get bigger. If babies are spitting up a lot, that's often a sign of overfeeding. And that's just what would happen if you or I ate a whole sausage pizza. You just run out of space. It just comes out the top. And so the baby just, it just comes out the top. Most babies, if you let them kind of pace themselves, and if you let them tell you that they're hungry, will not overeat.
Okay. Well, thank you. That was very helpful. And I have to say, I think you've nailed down the hungry baby impersonation. I was very impressed. So thank you for that. Okay. And then I guess just one follow-up to that, and we may have kind of touched upon this, but any signs that a baby's not getting enough to eat? You mentioned the hangry cry. Any other signs you might want to point out?
Yeah, this is something that a lot of breastfeeding parents especially worry about, because you don't know what's going in, and it's really hard to trust the process, and it's hard, and even as a pediatrician in the first couple days of life, I was like, how do I know she's getting enough? And the way you know that they're getting enough is they gain weight. Yeah, right? How can you not? You love your little person. How could you not worry about them? So they gain weight, and that's how you know. You can know by how much they're peeing and pooping. There's kind of an expected amount that we expect babies to pee and poop. We expect them to be making somewhere between 5 and 7, depends on how often you change it, pees per day by the first week of life, and, you know, poops that aren't constipated. And so if we're not having enough pees, we're not having enough poop, sometimes it's a sign a baby's not getting enough to eat. If babies look dehydrated, they're not getting enough to eat. So that's like a sticky mouth or a sunken soft spot. Things like that can be signs that a baby's gotten really dehydrated. And then early on, a baby who's jaundiced might be a little dehydrated too. That sometimes those things go together. But in general, this is something that the best way to know is to be tracking the weight. So you'd be working with your pediatrician to see if the baby's getting enough to eat.
Okay. Great. Well, thank you. You know, one last question and then we'll jump into our submitted questions. But let's talk about food allergies for a second. Definitely a hot quite concerning for parents. What are some signs of food allergies and maybe sensitivities, and then any ways to prevent food allergies?
Yeah. This is a really, really popular question in clinic. I often have people coming in for the 1 month visit or the newborn visit asking, when can I get my kid allergy tested? And the answer is that it's complicated, which is not a very easy answer. But most human beings will not have food allergies. And it really is as simple as that, is that most people are not going to have food allergies. And so if you don't have any symptoms of an allergy, I don't recommend allergy testing. In general, the first symptoms of allergies at a young age are usually on the skin, actually. So babies will get rashes. So it'll often be, so if it's a baby who is taking formula or breast milk, sometimes babies have really, really bad eczema, and that can sometimes be a sign of allergies. It's usually, honestly, usually a baby with bad eczema just has bad eczema, but sometimes it can be a sign of allergies. A baby who is starting on some solid foods, and let's say they had egg for the first time, and then they developed a rash, that can be a sign of an egg allergy. So rashes are often the first sign of an allergy to a new food. There is another type of allergy that's, it's a little bit of a different kind of immune system reaction, but it is an allergy too, which is a milk or a soy protein intolerance. And it's more an intolerance than an allergy, but the symptoms of that are usually changes to the poop. So the poops either get bloody, they get really mucousy, babies can have horrible, horrible reflux, babies can be miserable, cranky all the time. And babies can be not gaining weight well. I had one kid recently who was having a really, really hard time gaining weight until we put him on a special formula. So for the babies who can't digest milk or soy, there's a special formula out there that babies can go on that's like extremely broken down, so you don't react to it. It is actually also possible to continue breastfeeding a baby who has a milk or a soy protein intolerance, because it's not, again, this all boils back to, it's a cow milk protein intolerance, not a human milk protein intolerance. And so breastfeeding parents can stop eating cow milk proteins, and that can reduce the reaction for the baby. In terms of prevention, actually, one of the best ways to prevent food allergies is to introduce foods that you could be allergic to at a pretty young age, as long as the kid's low risk for food allergies. So again, as I had said, eczema, kid with really bad eczema probably needs to see an allergist. Kid with no eczema, kid who's healthy, they can start eating things like peanut butter, eggs, cow milk in the form of yogurt or something like that, prepared safely and in small quantities, starting from, between 4 and 6 months of age when you start solid foods. And starting those early actually can be a good way to prevent food allergies.
Okay. Really helpful there. So thank you so much for sharing that. I know I have a nut allergy myself, so I'm sure my mom wishes she maybe gave me some peanut butter a little bit earlier.
Well, it's a new thing. This actually was something that came about in the past couple of years, that we used to, as pediatricians, give guidance to families to say, don't give that peanut until they're three. And that turned out to be not so good advice. And, I think that we all need to have a dose of humility, especially around things like nutrition, because there's so much that we learn every day. But we try to keep up with the science as doctors.
Yeah, very, very interesting. And thank you so much for sharing. I know that it'll be very insightful for a lot of people watching. So thanks. Okay, so let's head into our live questions that we're getting. Thank you so much for submitting them. We have a few. So if Dr. Cullen, I'll kick it off to you. Our first question here, do you recommend calcium supplements for people who are lactose intolerant? And are there other ways to effectively get more calcium during and after pregnancy? Oh, and I think you're on mute. Yes. Easy to miss.
Sorry. Yeah, so sometimes I do recommend a calcium supplement. It kind of depends on what other parts of your diet, there are. So there's other foods that have calcium. Certainly, many people tend to get most of their calcium from dairy. And so if you feel like you can't get enough in other forms of food, like I said, again, sort of dark leafy greens have some calcium in them. There are some beans that have calcium. Sardines have a great amount of calcium in them. So there are ways, and I think, tofu has calcium. Yeah, that's right. So I think I often will tell people, honestly, just Google calcium high foods, because I don't have them all memorized because I eat a lot of dairy. But if you feel like those are foods that you don't eat or don't prefer and don't think you're going to be able to get enough of them, then yes, taking a calcium supplement is definitely a good idea. Many people, you know, struggle with bone loss later on in life, and it's not something that we want to start in our 20s or 30s if we can help it. So if you feel like you can't get enough calcium from food supplements or from food sources, rather, then I think adding a supplement is absolutely the right thing to do.
Okay, perfect. Thank you. Another question for you, this time talking about vegetables. Is there a specific way those superfood vegetables that you mentioned should be prepared to preserve the most nutrients? So for example, if I'm roasting broccoli, am I reducing the amount of nutrients compared to eating it steamed or raw?
Yes, you are. You know, ultimately, I think if you can't eat it, I mean, most people don't eat a ton of raw broccoli. Some people do. And I think, you know, in some small amounts you can. The more that you cook something, the more it loses its vitamins. So if you're cooking something, the steaming it and keeping it a little bit crisp is going to be the best way to keep it with most of its vitamins, or eating it raw is even better. Again, many people can't really, don't prefer, or don't eat a lot of raw vegetables, and that's okay. But the less cooked, the better. And certainly steaming and kind of actually when it gets that even brighter green color, that's the time to stop. Because that's for beans and for broccoli, that's when it still contains most of its nutrients and they haven't been broken down by the heat.
Good to know.
One thing I will say that I talk about with parents of toddlers who have trouble getting iron is that if you cook in cast iron, that is actually something that can add some nutrition to your foods. So like not everything goes, some things get added when you cook. Like you can, if you cook in cast iron, your foods will pick up some of that iron, and it can be a way to help improve the iron content of especially a vegetarian diet.
And also thinking about like olive oil and healthy fats, which are a great thing to add to your diet. So certainly cooking is not negative in all ways, but it does to some degree, and especially things that are super overcooked, you're going to lose some of the vitamin content.
Okay. Very good to know. Interesting about that cast iron. I'm going to look into that. that's a helpful.
Yeah, there's a product that I've read about also called the Lucky Fish that I've had a few people ask me about. It's a little iron-shaped fish. It's really cute, but it's also a little expensive. And what I've talked about with a lot of my families is, you know, if you just cook in grandma's old cast iron pot, that's way less expensive, and it'll add that iron to your food too.
Because you can put that fish in like stews and stuff, right? Like to cook it and then take it out. Obviously, you don't eat it, but it's like an iron,
crunchy
iron to your food. Just chomp on the iron fish.
Very interesting. Thank you. Okay, Dr. Brehm, just two questions for you, and then we are just about out of time. But quickly, do milk or soy intolerances usually resolve as babies grow?
Yeah, that's a really good question. Almost always. They take a varying amount of time. So it sort of depends on how bad it was. A lot of them resolve by age one. And then an even larger chunk will resolve by age two. You know, if we're getting into early toddlerhood and it's not gotten better, I will often hook families up with seeing a specialist, either gastroenterology or GI, to talk it over. But almost everybody gets better with time.
Okay, well, that's reassuring to hear. Thank you. okay, and our last question, do newborns need iodine? And if so, why? Mm-hmm. Is it found in formula, breast milk? As kids get older, do we need to go out of our way to make sure they're getting maybe iodized salt?
Yeah, that's a great question. Yeah, I mean, iodine is a really, really important nutrient, but it historically, lack of iodine in food used to cause something called congenital hypothyroidism. And so it would, if you don't have enough iodine, you don't make a thyroid. But these days there's enough iodine hanging out in our salt that even if you buy sea salt, like it's hard to be iodine deficient. If you ate exclusively unprocessed food that you made yourself with only all natural sea salt and didn't eat any high iodine food, you could potentially become iodine deficient, but it's actually really hard to be iodine deficient as a kid, at least, because all of that heavy lifting that your mother did during pregnancy to make your body, that's already been done. And so the iodine requirements are just not as high when you're already born. You've already got thyroid gland.
Okay, well, thank you. This was super informative. I want to thank you both. We are just about out of time, but I do want to give an opportunity for any final comments just to close out this evening. So Dr. Cullen, would you like to start?
Sure. So I think, you know, again, the things to take away from a prenatal nutrition are really that extra 300 or so calories a day, focusing on those nutrients, trying to remember your prenatal vitamin and not feeling guilty when you can't eat in your first trimester. And also not feeling guilty when you can't lose that weight if you're breastfeeding, and that there's such a spectrum of what's normal that it's okay. If you're really concerned, you should talk to your OBGYN or your pediatrician and kind of, you know, and reach out to your resources. But for the most part, it's within the range of normal.
Okay, I like that. Don't feel guilty.
Well, thank you. And, you know, yeah. As parents, we feel guilty a lot about things, whatever things those might be. There's lots of them, and then lots of guilt around holding on to weight, or, you know, not being able to breastfeed, or whatever all these struggles are. And it's difficult, and it's all worth it in the end, but it's hard. And there's a lot of guilt that goes along with it. So, you know, everybody's different. Everybody's body is different, and how they change during pregnancy and after pregnancy is different for every person.
Absolutely. And I think to hear it from you, a physician yourself, is certainly reassuring. So thank you for kind of reminding of that. So thank you. Okay, Dr. Brem, any final comments from you?
Yeah, I mean, I will echo a lot of that. Trusting yourself, especially if you're a breastfeeding parent, you'll work with your pediatrician and your OB. If your baby's gaining weight, you're doing great. If you choose to do formula, or if breastfeeding isn't working out for you, that's fine too. We have a lot of excellent commercially available products that you can choose to use for your child that provide excellent nutrition. I'll also echo that vitamin D is super important, and almost all babies early on in their life should have vitamin D. After they start eating solid foods, there's lots and lots of different things you can do. You can talk to your pediatrician about it. We didn't really get into that too much because we're focusing on the early times of life. But, you know, trust yourself as a parent, and as long as your kid's getting weight, you're probably doing fine.
Okay, great. Well, thank you. And okay, vitamin D, and don't always trust TikTok, right?
Oh yeah, never trust TikTok.
That's a good
actually,
rule.
Actually, no, I will say, I was impressed by, actually, there's a lot of people that are trying to combat misinformation. And so about half of the formula recipes that I found were somebody who posted a, this is why this is really bad response. Which I was very heartened to see as a pediatrician.
Well, there you go. It's not all bad.
Not all bad.
Okay, good to know. Well, thank you. We appreciate it. Well, thank you to our panelists again, and for all of you who tuned in. Again, we have recorded the session, and we'll be sharing the link with you and on our social media channels in the coming days. So if you have any more questions, we encourage you to visit jeffersonhealth.org/maternity or kidshealth.org, which is the most visited site for pediatric health information. Experts at Jefferson Health and Nemours Children's Health are also available when you need care. Visit jeffersonhealth.org or nemours.org to find the best care for you and your family. Thank you once again for joining us this evening, and please be sure to stay safe and healthy. Have a wonderful night. Thank you.